Hello everyone, my name is Zulkarnain Hayat and welcome to learning Nginx course. Nginx is an open source high performance web server that powers many modern web applications. Nginx is the best at serving static content, integrates with other applications to deliver dynamic sites, and can also function as a load balancer and proxy server. Nginx become more popular. Knowing the fundamentals of Nginx will be a valuable skill for web developers, system administrator, and application admins. Nginx offers speed unique by a competitor like Apache. On top of bonus features such as load balancing and HTTP caching, its growing popularity makes Nginx is a key skill for web developers, system administrator, and web admins. This course is a beginner level learning training course. Shows you how to install and configure Nginx on Linux machine and how to set up the rest of pieces you need for the complete LEMP web development stack, and also explores the security feature of Nginx such as password authentication, HTTPS and SSL certificates, and its capabilities as a reverse proxy and load balancing. In this course, these are topics we are going to be covered: how to installing Nginx on Linux, how to configuring a virtual host, how to installing PHP and MariaDB for the LEMP stack, how to securing sites with Nginx, how to creating SSL certificates, how to use reverse proxy setup, how to do load balancing. So grab some coffee or tea, let's get started. Linux servers are the preferred system for running as a base operating system. To follow along with this course, I will expect you to be familiar with running commands from the Linux command line interface. You will also need to know how to edit files using an editor like VIA or Nano editor. You will also need to have some familiarity with installing applications and managing Linux services. It's not required, but it will be helpful if you have experience with the Apache HTTP web server, since some of terms and concepts will be similar. If you want a quick overview on Linux and Apache before starting this course, you can review my course on Udemy. It named Linux Basic or Linux Supercharge for beginners. I will share URL and coupon code in end of this course. I will also be discussing static and dynamic websites. So knowing some basic HTML, PHP and MySQL will be beneficial, but it's also not a requirement. We can't discuss Nginx without also taking a moment to reflect on the Apache HTTP server. Apache, as it's more commonly known as, is an open source web server that's been leading the market for more than 20 years. In fact, the term LEMP is an abbreviation for servers that run Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. A very popular application stack for delivering dynamic web content. So you might be wondering why use Nginx when Apache is such an integral part of delivering web content. What's the difference between Apache and Nginx? First, let's take a look at a few of the ways they are similar. Both Apache and Nginx are free and open source software. This means that anyone can use the software without paying for it, and the source code is available for download along with binary version of the application. This also means that the community of users behind both applications can review the code for bugs and suggest changes to be included in future versions. Both applications are compiled binaries, but they can extend it by dynamically including modules at runtime. This allows users to add additional functionality as needed. Both Apache and Nginx can be configured as a proxy server, allowing them to pass requests onto other applications and then return the content back to the requester. And finally, Nginx and newer version of Apache use event-based processing. This means they can both efficiently handle a large number of simultaneously connections. In past version of Apache, each connection was handled by a worker process that required additional system resources for each new connection that was made. This could easily lead to the server consuming all resources under very heavy load. By adding event-based processing, newer version of Apache are able to handle a high number of connections. On par with Nginx, now let's look at a few differences. One of the most clear differences is the configuration format used by Apache and Nginx. Apache uses a format that based on XML and can be verbose with open and closing tags for each section. Nginx, on the other hand, uses a syntax very similar to the C programming language with directives and block defined by opening and close brackets. Programmer working with Nginx configuration might find this a bit more like programming compared to Apache, which might feel more like writing a document. Apache also provides for a distributed configuration through the use of .atxs files. Each directory under the web server root directory can contain a configuration file specifically for that directory. This has its benefit by allowing default configuration to be overwritten, but it also can slow down processing because the .atxs file must be processed before each request. Nginx uses a more centralized configuration with all configuration files loaded at the same time. Instead of configuring by a directory, Nginx instead uses location block that can map requests to location inside the web server's root directory, somewhere else on the file system, or some other application for processing. Speaking of other applications, when it comes to processing dynamic content, Apache can minimize or eliminate the need for other applications. By including modules for language like PHP, Python, and Perl directory in its binary, Apache can serve these type of dynamic content on its own. Nginx would need to rely on an external application for dynamic processing, but when it comes to serving static content, Nginx takes the lead over Apache. In various tests, Nginx is found to be a little more than twice as fast as Apache when serving static content. Nginx also has built-in capability for caching content, which can lead to faster responses from the server. Apache can be configured as a cache with a module, but the configuration may be different. So with these similarities and differences to consider, why should we choose Nginx? While Apache maintains a strong lead in a web server deployment, Nginx has been quickly gaining in popularity since its public release in 2004. As more developers and engineers switch to Nginx, there's a noticeable decline in Apache's usage. Learning and using Nginx now will help you to stay up the date with what may soon become the market leading web server. We have also discussed how Nginx is efficient and consistent under heavy loads. If developers are trying to deploy applications in environments that have limited resources like small CPU and limited RAM, deploying a web server that operates consistent can provide for more predictable performance. And along with efficiency and multiple capabilities, many find Nginx easier to configure than Apache. This can make Nginx easier to learn for people that are just getting into application development and system administration. Now that we have a better idea of why we should learn Nginx, let's get started. Get up running with Nginx, we will be using a Ubuntu server, sandbox environment powered by virtual machine and Vagrant. We will use these applications along with exercise files developed for the course. The exercise files contain Vagrant files for VMs that match specific lessons and other files. I will be using like a fully designed website, custom error pages and database files. If you are not using the exercise files, you can still follow along with the VM running Ubuntu Server 18.04. VirtualBox is a free and open source application that will let us run virtual machines or VMs on standard computers like desktops and laptops. In my case, I have a laptop Lenovo and I am running Oracle VirtualBox top on it. Using VirtualBox, we will be able to create VM running the Ubuntu operating system where we will install and configure Nginx. You can install VirtualBox by going to virtualbox.org and clicking the big blue button and then clicking the link that corresponds to your system as you can see on the screen. This downloads an installer. All you need to do is run the installer and accept the default settings or options. We won't need to interface with VirtualBox very much. Instead, we will be using Vagrant to control the creation and removal of our VMs. With VirtualBox running in the background, Vagrant is also a free and open source application that automates the process for creating VMs. With Vagrant, we can quickly and easily create VM in a repeatable and predictable fashion. Vagrant uses files called base boxes to define the basic component of virtual machines running on VirtualBox. Another file called a Vagrant file is used to customize and configure the base box. You can install Vagrant by first going to vagrantapp.com and clicking download for the latest version. On the download page, choose the correct version for your system and follow the link. Once the download completes, run the installer and accept the defaults. If you are on Windows system, you might also consider installing VirtualBox and Vagrant with the Chocolatey package manager, or if you are on Mac operating system, you could also install these tools using the Homebrew package manager. I have already installed these on my system using all of the default options. Once you have the apps installed, open a command window on your system, either cmd or PowerShell on Windows or Terminal on Mac. I am running Terminal on Mac. You can verify the application or installed properly by running vbox manage space dash dash version. In this course, I am using Windows operating system. For the vbox manage command, note the capital letter in the name of the command. To verify Vagrant is installed properly, type Vagrant space dash dash version. These commands should print their version for the respective application if it's installed properly. So in next lecture, we are going to create a VM with Vagrant. So be with me. See you in next lecture. Now that we have VirtualBox and Vagrant installed, let's create our first VM. On my system, I have downloaded the exercise file and unzipped the content in my download folder. As you can see on the screen, this directory has a Vagrant file that describes the VM we will be creating. If you already have something running on your system that uses this IP address, you can avoid IP address conflicts by using a different IP address for your Vagrant box. Let's take a look inside this file. Even if you don't know Ruby, the programming language that Vagrant files are written in, it's fairly straightforward to figure out what's going on. The first line in the file sets the IP address that the VM will be configured to use. The following lines configure the VM by calling out the base box and a network configuration. In this case, the base box is the Ubuntu 18.04 box from the Ubuntu library. This base box and other like it are freely available on the web. The last few lines of the Vagrant file print out a message with the URL for the VM's IP address. To start the VM, we simply run Vagrant up. This will start the process of loading the base box. If you have not downloaded the base box before, Vagrant will download it for you. Now, after this download, you won't have to download the base box again for any other VMs you create that use the same base box. After the Vagrant up command completes, the VM is running and all we need to do is connect to it. We do that with the Vagrant SSH command. This logs up into the VM with SSH or secure shell as the default user, which in this case is named Vagrant. Once we logged in, we have full control of the VM just like any other Linux server. To log out, we can type exit or type control plus D. To stop the VM, we run the command Vagrant halt. Doing this, power down the VM and preserve the current state. If we want to pick up where we left off, we can restart the VM by running Vagrant up again. If we are done with the VM, we can completely remove it by running vagrant destroy. I will type the vagrant destroy command here just to show you what it looks like, but you don't need to run the command at this time. Before the VM is destroyed, we are prompted to confirm that we really want to destroy it. The default is no, so you have to type Y and then press return. This stops the VM if it is running and then remove any file associated with the VM. This command does not remove the vagrant file. Using vagrant and these few commands, we can easily create and manage VMs for our sandbox environment. For more in-depth lesson on using vagrant, you can see my course on Udemy, which named on vagrant. In this chapter, we will install and configure Nginx. Getting Nginx installed only takes a few commands. But first we need a server. I will start in a directory with a vagrant file and use vagrant to create a Linux VM running the Ubuntu operating system. If you are picking up the course with this lesson and need more information on vagrant, you can find more detail in my Udemy course. I will start my VM and with the vagrant up command, this loads the base box and starts our VM. Once the VM is up and running, I will connect to it with vagrant SSH. This logs me in as a vagrant user and now I can install Nginx. But because I am not logged in as a root user, first I need to do sudo to the root user. The first thing I will do is run apt update. This will make sure the Ubuntu server has the latest information on all packages that are available to be installed. Once the package information has been updated, I can upgrade any package that are out of date. I will do that with the apt upgrade command. I am prompted to confirm the upgrade and since the default is yes, I will press the return key to proceed. Once the upgrade is complete, I can now install Nginx. I will do that by running apt space install space Nginx. Similar to the upgrade step, I am prompted to continue the installation, which I can do pressing the enter key. Once the install is complete, I can confirm the installation by typing nginx-v. If the installation was successful, Nginx should respond with the version that was just installed. Because Nginx gets installed as a service that runs continuously, we can also use the systemctl command to check the status of Nginx service. We do this by entering systemctl space status space Nginx. In this status report, we can see that the service has been loaded and is actively running. Because the output is presented in the pager, we need to type Q to quit out of the systemctl status report and get back to our command prompt. There one more way we can confirm Nginx is installed correctly, and it's maybe the most important way. We can use a browser and request the page from the server. In browser, we will type our Ubuntu server IP, this IP address that my development server is using and the Nginx is listening on using port 80. The response from the server is a page welcoming us to Nginx. This is default page that gets installed along with the software. Seeing this page is the ultimate confirmation that the server is installed correctly and all systems are running as expected. Now that we know our installation is working, the next thing to do is get familiar with some of the files and directories that are key to running Nginx on Linux system. Now that we know our Nginx installation is working, the next thing to do is get familiar with some of the files and directories that are key to running Nginx on a Linux system. These will be the directories and files you are mostly likely to interact with this. Let's start with /etc/nginx. The /etc/nginx directory holds the configuration for the entire Nginx installation. Inside this directory, you will find the files that control the way the web server runs along with the files that define the website being served. The main configuration file is /etc/nginx.conf. Also inside the /etc/nginx directory, we find the config.d site-available and site-enable directories. As you can see on the screen, these locations are where we will store our server configuration files. If you are familiar with the term virtual host or vhost, Nginx server configuration files are very similar in function to Apache's vhost files. In fact, you will see the term vhost and server configuration used interchangeably when discussing Nginx. For example, configuration is stored in /etc/nginx/sites-available. Default, this configuration sets up the welcome to Nginx page that we use to confirm the server was installed and running correctly. Two other directories that I want to mention are outside of the main /etc/nginx directory. These are /var/log/nginx and /var/www. /var/log/nginx is the directory where Nginx stores the log files. With an out-of-the-box installation, you will find the access log and error log files in this directory. The access log records any accesses that the web server processes along with detail like the time the access occurred, the IP address of the requester, and the file that was requested. Nginx uses the error log to record any problems with the web server and other operational details. And finally, there's /www. This location is used to store the actual files that get served to a client, including HTML, images, and any other document that are stored on the server. The default directory for this is /www/html. However, as we create and define new server configuration in vhost, we will be creating our own directories in /var/www to accommodate the files that get served. Like many other Linux services, Nginx is controlled by its command line interface or CLI. Let's take a look at some of commands we will be using as we get more familiar with the Nginx. Keep in mind that you need to either be logged in as a root user or the command with sudo to enable root privileges as the command is run. Since I will be running several commands that require root privileges, I will become the root user by typing sudo su-, Now we can check the status of nginx service with systemctl space status space nginx. This gives a brief report letting us know the service is running, how long it's been running, and some details on how the process was started. This command uses a pager by default, so you have to type Q to end the status report and get back to the prompt. One way to get around this is to use the no pager switch, so I can run same command with dash dash no dash pager. As you can see on the screen, this gives us the complete output and then goes right back to the command prompt. We can also use systemctl to stop and start nginx. We just need to follow systemctl with the desired command and then the name of our service nginx. For example, starting looks like this: systemctl space start space nginx, and stopping is pretty much the same: systemctl space stop space nginx. One thing to note about the start and stop command is that they don't produce any output. To make sure these commands ran successfully, it's good practice to follow them with the isActive command. Since I just run the stop command, I can run systemctl dash active nginx. The inactive message lets us know that indeed nginx is not running. Now let's check the start command, and again I will run systemctl is active nginx. As you can see on the screen, this produces an active message, so we know that nginx is started and is actively running. The last systemctl command we will need is the reload command. This command tells nginx to reload all configuration files from the disk. Because nginx loads its configuration into memory when it starts, the reload command is needed if we make any changes to the configuration and want to have them applied. An alternative to this is stopping and starting nginx, but this would cause the service to be offline from the time we ran the stop command until the time we successfully ran the start command. In case of reloading, on the other hand, keep the service running. So I will run systemctl space reload space nginx. Like the start and stop command, the reload command does not produce any output. If we need to confirm the reload, we can run the systemctl space status command again. At the end of status report, we can see two lines on seeing the service is reloading and other letting us know the service reloaded successfully. Along with this command, systemctl commands, we can also use nginx command directly. To get list of switches, we can run nginx dash h. This lists the version being run and some of options we can use. For us, the most useful switches will be the lowercase and uppercase t switches. These let us test the nginx configuration. Using the lowercase t, check the configuration without stopping or reloading the service. Using this option, we can make changes to the configuration and then test from B before reloading it. An OK message means the configuration is good. Using the capital T, test configuration and then print it to the screen. Using a pager like less or more with this command lets you browse through the output one page at a time. So if I run this command again and pipe it to less, I can scroll page by page with the spacebar or line by line with the arrow keys. Since Nginx configuration can be stored over many different files, using the dash capital T option can be helpful for seeing the entire configuration in one place. So next lecture, we will go inside Nginx configuration file. So be with me. See you in next lecture. Let's create our first server configuration. My development VM is already up and running, and I am connected to it as a default user. Since we will need evaluated privileges for many of the commands we will be running, I just type sudo space su space dash. Let's get rid of that default site. We know Nginx is working fine, so we don't need this configuration anymore. We will find the default configuration in /etc/nginx/sites-enabled. Because the default configuration is linked to a file in sites-available, we can remove that link with the unlink command. If you want to make sure the default file that was linked to is still there, you can check the content of the sites-available directory. Now we need to create the configuration file that will hold configuration for our site. We'll be storing our configuration in /etc/nginx/config.d. We'll be setting up a demo site, as you can see on the screen, and our demo site will be, as you can see on the screen, I will use via to edit the file name based on our domains, demo domain name. In the config.d directory, it's good practice to name the vhost file after the site to keep things organized. Since a single Nginx server can run multiple sites, naming the configuration file the same as the site makes things easier to manage. It's also important that we use the .config extension so that the vhost gets picked up by Nginx when we reload the configuration. If there's ever a vhost that we don't want to use, we can either remove the file or just rename it. So .config is not the file extension. Inside the file, I will start the vhost with the server directive and a set of opening and closing curly braces to define the server block. Now we can add a listen directive to tell Nginx which port to listen on for request to serve this site. The default port for a web service to listen on is 80. So we will use that here. We also need to add the root directory where our site will be served from. This defines the path to the actual HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that will make up our website. It's good practice to give the root directory the same name as the site, as you can see on the screen, and I will end the directory with the semicolon. Now we can save this file and check out the configuration. There's our vhost. Now let's use the nginx command with the -t switch to test the configuration. If all went well, we should see output from the nginx stating that the syntax is okay and the test was successful. Now we need to reload the configuration into the running server. To do that, we will use the systemctl command and tell it to reload nginx. If all goes well with this step, we won't see any output here, but we can confirm with the systemctl space status command. At the very end of this output, we that nginx was successfully reloaded. Now let's create the directory that we used in the server config. Just to make sure that our configuration is correct, let's put a test file in that directory. We can put a simple one is in there just to confirm that all is well. Now let's take a look at the site to see the response. I will open browser and go to the IP address for our development server. As you can see, our site is not much to look at, but seeing the test message gives some confidence that once we put content into the root directory, it will be served as expected. Let's take a look at the simple server configuration that we already have in place. We have configured the port this server will be listening on and the root directory where the files for our site will be stored. Now let's edit the file and add a few more directives. First, let's add the default underscore server directive to the listen statement. Because Nginx can serve multiple files from the same IP address, we can use the default underscore server statement to tell Nginx to use the server configuration. If no other configurations match the name of the site being requested, which leads to the next item we need to add, the name of the server, which is also the name of the site. If you're familiar with the Apache vhost configuration, this is similar to setting up a name-based vhost. By including the server name and website name, we let Nginx know which site the server configuration applies to. Otherwise, if we were serving multiple sites from the same IP address, Nginx might serve the wrong content. For more information on how Nginx matches server names when the request is received, take a look at the Nginx documentation page, how Nginx processes a request. Now let's add our next directive, which is index. The index directive tells Nginx what file to use when it responds to a request. In this case, we are telling Nginx to look for a file name index.html, which is already the default. We can add other name to the directive and Nginx will look for them in the order in which they are listed. So if the index file will be index.html or index.php, we can add those and Nginx will use the first one that match in the root directory. Now let's test the updated configuration to make sure we did not introduce any error. For that, we will use nginx space dash t again, and with no error, as you can see on the screen, we can go ahead and reload the configuration with systemctl space reload space nginx. We did not get any errors from our systemctl reload command, so let's go ahead and test the site. Instead of going to the browser, I will just use curl space localhost, and there's our message, site coming soon. So everything working as planned. Now we can move on to adding the website files. After getting our server configuration in place, we are ready to add some actual content to our website. The exercise file for this lesson include a zip file with HTML images and other files we will need for the site. It's important that we run Vagrant up inside the directory with these exercise files so we can take advantage of Vagrant and VirtualBox sync directories. With sync directories, all the files in this directory will be available once we are logged into the VM. This will keep us from having to copy files up into the VM. If you are not following along with exercise files, you will need to use secure copy or scp to get your zip file up to the server. Let's go ahead and connect to development server with vagrant SSH and switch to the root user. Now I can cd to the slash vagrant directory. This is directory that I was telling you about that gets synchronized between the local workstation and the virtual machine. If I run ls, we can see the zip file for the demo site. Before we can do anything with the zip file, we need to make sure the unzip command is installed on the VM. We can check this by running which unzip command. If this return a path to unzip for you, then you are all set. In this case, unzip is not installed. So we need to install it. We can do that running apt space install space unzip. Now we can confirm that unzip is available. Now let's make sure our root directory is there. In this case, we see the index, that HTML file we created during the server configuration. If you get an error like no such file or directory, go ahead and create the directory with the mkdir command. Now let's zip the file. We will enter unzip space dash o, the file name, and then dash d followed by the root directory. As you can see on the screen, the dash o tells unzip to overwrite our index file, and dash d tells unzip where we want to file to be extracted. Now let's cd into the root directory and take a look at the files. The content is there and it's in the right place. Now we need to update the permission. Right now the files and directories are owned by the root user, but the permissions are set in such a way that the files could be modified by any user. In other words, the directory and files are writable, making the site vulnerable. To keep our site safe, we need to fix the permission by locking them down. We can do this by changing the files and directory to be writable by the root user and read only to everyone else. We also want directories to have the execute properties in place, since that needed for them to function properly as directories. To set these permission, we can use the find function to do this for us. We will use the command find and then directory dash type f dash execute exec chmod space 644 curly bracket open curly close. As you can see on the screen, this command is going to find all of the files in this directory and execute the chmod 644 command on each of them one at a time. Then we will do the same thing for the directory under our site root. We will just change the type to d for directory and the chmod to 755. Now if we look at the files and directories again, we can see that permission are set properly. So that the files are in place, let's take a look at the site in browser. I will enter the IP address for our development server, and there's our site. It took some, but finally we are getting our site served. This is great accomplishment, but it's not the last step is in getting our site up and running on Nginx. There's still much more functionality that we can add. Let's discuss how we can make the configuration for our demo site more robust by adding location directives. Location directives allow us to extend our configuration based on URI or a uniform resource indicator that makes up the request being processed by the server. When we define a location, we use the location keyword, an optional modifier, and required location definition. Location directive are formatted as a blocks and are defined inside server blocks. They can also be nested inside other location block. Inside the location block, we can include other directives. Specifically, we can include just about any directive that can be defined inside a server block. This makes location very useful since we can configure Nginx to process different requests in ways similar to server block without having to create additional servers. When Nginx processes location, it uses a series of matches to determine the best one to use. First, considering exact matches, then location with prefixes, and then location with regular expressions. For more information on location, take a look at the documentation on nginx.org. Let's continue by going back to our development server as the root user and editing the configuration for our demo site. Let's add a new location block for an empty request or just the slash character. This will correspond to the root directory of our site. Inside this block, we will add another directive, try file, try files. The try files directive gives Nginx list of files or directories to look for relative to the location. The first file or directory that match gets processed. If no item in the list match, then the last item in the list is used as a URI or an error code. For this location, we will use the URI variable. To first look for a file that match the URI being processed, then we will add the URI variable followed by a slash to test for any directories that might match. And lastly, we will add is equal to 404 to tell Nginx to serve a 404 error if no file or directory matches the URI being requested. Let's add another location for the image directory. And in this location, let's add the directive autoindex and use the keyword on. The autoindex directory will let the browser list the file in that directory. This means we will be able to see the files in that directory from a browser. This behavior is turned off by default. And now let's add a couple more directive and location for custom error pages. When Nginx cannot find any content to respond to the request, it displays a 404 error page. And if there are any server side issues, Nginx will display a 500 error page. In these cases, we have added an error page directive to tell Nginx to use our custom pages instead of the default. For these custom pages, we have also added a location directive with an equal sign, also known as the exact match modifier. And inside the location block, we have added the internal directive which tells Nginx to process any redirect to the custom 404 page as an internal redirect. Both of these, the exact match modifier and internal redirect, will help Nginx serve our custom error page more quickly. Testing the 404 page will be easy. We can just request a page that we know our site is not set up to serve. But since we don't have any server side processing in place, we need to add a specific location to test our 500 page. To do this, we can create fake fast CGI pass that we know we fail. Now let's save the file and exit and test the configuration with nginx-t. The configuration looks good, so we can load it with systemctl reload. Now let's test the location we just added. First, let's check the site. If we refresh the page, we see our site is loading properly and still looks good. Now let's check the images location by browsing to slash images. Because we use to auto index directory, we can see the content of this directory again. This is not default behavior, but because we used auto index on, we can turn it on and see a list of images in this location. Now let's check our custom 404 page. This can be checked by just going to the location that we know is not defined in our site, like slash missing, and there's our custom 404 page with a cute little chicken. Now let's test the 500 location, and there's our custom 500 page with two more cute little chickens. This lets us know that all of our locations are in place and properly configured. Nginx uses log files to record various operational details. These logs are useful for monitoring normal operations and tracking down issues if a problem occurs. Let's start by taking a look inside the main configuration file, nginx.conf. Inside this file, if we search for log, we can find two entries, access underscore log and error underscore log. As you can see on the screen, the access log is where nginx records each request that it serves, whether the request is served successfully or not. Each request can be recorded along with various metadata like the date and time of the request, the IP address of the requester, and the path to the document that was served. Nginx uses the error log to store operational details ranging from debug information to warning and critical errors. If Nginx is set up to serve multiple sites, but the default logging configuration is used, then all the requests for all the sites will be written to the same logs. This can become an issue if, for example, you need to find the access log for one specific site. Fortunately, logging can be configured in the server and location context. Let's set up logging for our demo site. First, let's edit our configuration file. Now we can add access logs and error logs specifically for this virtual host. With the access log and error log directives followed by the path to the file, and I like to add these close to the top of the configuration, as you can see on the screen. And just for the demonstration purpose, let's also add access and error log in the images location. Now let's save this, test our configuration and reload it. It looks like we forgot to add semicolon after some of the statements that we just added. Let's fix that. One more time, let's test this configuration. Looks good. So now let's reload it. If we change to log directory, we can see that our new log files have been created, but they are empty because no requests have come through yet. Instead of loading the page in the browser, we can use a for loop to curl localhost 10 times while sending the output to /dev/null. And now if we look inside the access log for our site, we can see 10 records that correspond to the 10 curls that we just made. We can do the same thing for the images location. Because we are requesting a directory location, we need to add trailing slash in this case. And now if we check the content of the images access log, we can see the log for each request. Seeing the content in the access files for both of these locations lets us know that our custom logging directives are configured properly. As you are working with Nginx, there may be come a time when things just are not working. Here are few tools and ideas you can use to troubleshoot and resolve some of the typical problems you might encounter. We can catch configuration errors with nginx --t after making changes. If there is some mistake in your configuration file, nginx --t will identify the error. The first thing you can do is make sure nginx is running. The systemctl --status nginx command give output that confirm whether nginx is running or not. Then you might also want to reload the configuration with systemctl reload --nginx. This command does not produce any output if it runs successfully, so check the site afterward to see if your changes are now being applied. If nginx up and running but you are not seeing anything served, you will want to check that the standard ports for HTTP and HTTPS traffic are open, like port 80 and 443. You can check the status of these ports using the ls off and netstate Linux commands. Ls off, which is a short for list open files, list all the file and network port that are open on the system. Using the -i switch, we can check to see if nginx is listing on port 80 and 443. Another way to confirm nginx is listening on this port is with network status or netstate command. Using netstate command, netstate give us information on all of the network connection for the system. Using the right switches --pln, as you can see on the screen, and grepping for nginx. We can also get netstate to give us the ID of process that listening to the port. If your configuration is good and nginx is up, running and listening on the right ports, but something is still out of place, it's time to turn to the logs. You can use the tail command with the -f switch to follow the error, to follow the nginx log as they are being written to the disk. It's also called runtime log. While following the log, you can try to access various parts of your site and see if accesses are being recorded. If they are, you can check for 400 errors, which might lead to the problem like files not being in the right place or directories that don't have the correct permissions. If all else fails, seek help. You can turn to a search engine or HTTP. stackoverflow.com to research the error or problem that you are seeing. Hopefully someone else has encountered the same problem and provided a solution. Finding solution to your problems might take a while at first, but as you gain more experience with nginx, your troubleshooting will become much more efficient. When it comes to websites and web application development, many people use the term stack to describe the environment where these sites and applications are developed. The typical web server stack consists of four parts: an operating system, a web server, a database, and a scripting language. For many years, the primary web stack has been the LEMP stack. In this case, Linux is the operating system, the web server is Apache, and the database component is a MySQL or MariaDB, and the scripting language is either PHP, Python, or Perl. Because the components of web stack can be swapped out, using nginx for the web server leads to the LEMP stack. The other component remain the same. In this case, nginx is represented by the letter E for the sound of the nginx name rather than its spelling. Now let's take a look at getting configured to run dynamic application with nginx, MariaDB, and PHP. In this lecture, we're going to install PHP on nginx. I am already connected to our development VM with Nginx installed. Now let's install PHP. PHP actually is a general purpose scripting language especially suited to web development. You can learn more about PHP at php.net. We will be working as the root user, so we need to elevate our session with sudo space su dash. Now we can run apt update to make sure the package repository are up to date. And now we can install the PHP packages. We will do this with apt space install space php dash fpm and php dash mysql. As you can see on the screen, this will install the PHP fast CGI process manager and any other packages we need for a PHP. The fast CGI process manager is a service that will process any PHP files received by the web server. And a PHP MySQL package is a package that allows PHP to connect to a MySQL database. Once the installation is complete, we can check the version of PHP that got installed by running php space dash dash version command. In this case, as you can see the version. Now let's check the PHP fast CGI process manager. This gets installed as a service and we can make sure it's up and running with systemctl. For PHP fast CGI, the name of the service, as you can see on the screen, the output tells us the php-fpm is up and running. At this point, we are ready to configure Nginx so that it can communicate with the PHP service. So let's edit our config file for our site. In the config file, we need to add a location with the case-sensitive regular expression that match URIs ending in .php. Next, we will use the include directive to bring in some code that's stored outside of our config file. The fastcgi-php.config file contains helpful directives that improve the security and efficiency of the site. Now let's add a fastcgi_pass directive. The directive tells Nginx to use a Unix socket to communicate with php-fpm. Communicating through a socket keeps the transfer between Nginx and PHP on the local system much faster than the communicating via a TCP port. We can also add one more directive, fastcgi_intercept_errors, and then add the keyword on. As you can see on the screen, this tells Nginx that if any error are returned by the fast CGI server, in this case php-fpm, that Nginx should try to process that error with an error pay directive if possible. Nginx will consider errors from the fast CGI process as the 500 errors. So these will be handled by our custom 50x.html page. As you can see on the screen, now let's save the file and test our configuration. Everything looks good there. So let's go ahead and reload the configuration. Now the only thing we need to some PHP content. Let's create a PHP info page in the root directory of the demo site. In this file, we will put some PHP code that will return detail about our PHP installation. These commands will provide detail on our PHP installation served as a dynamically generated web page. I should add that making the PHP info function output available on the web page should only be used for development and never in the production environment. The details on the page might give a hacker or other people or visitor to our site more information about our site then they need making it a target for attack. So we can go to the browser and test the info page on our demo site. Now entered 192.168.0.3, which is the IP address for our site, and then info.php. As you can see, info page confirmed that we have PHP FPM installed and Nginx configured to use it for processing web pages with the PHP. Let's wrap up the session here and move on to installing the database server for our LEMP stack, MariaDB. So be with me. See you in next lecture. In this lesson, we are going to install MariaDB on Nginx. MariaDB is an open source Debian of the popular MySQL database. It uses the same interface and commands as the MySQL. You can learn more about MariaDB at mariadb.org. I am connected to our development server as a root user. As we already installed Nginx and PHP and configured, now let's install MariaDB. We will be installing the database server along with the client that we are allowed to easily create and manipulate databases. We will do this with apt space install space MariaDB dash server and MariaDB dash client. As you can see on the screen, it will take little time to install. Once the installation is completed, we can confirm all is well by checking the status of the server with systemctl. One thing to note here is that even though we installed the MariaDB server, it still uses the name MySQLD. It also uses MySQL for the client, which we can check with the dash version switch. Now that we have our MariaDB client and server installed, let's secure the installation. The initial installation for the database server includes some defaults that we need to change to make things more secure. For example, we need to set a root password, disable remote connection for the root, and remove anonymous accounts. These steps may not be necessary for a development environment, but they are definitely required for databases used in the production environment. Getting into the habit of securing your database installation is a good thing. It is also quick, easy, and can keep you from getting hacked. All we have to do is use a tool called MySQL Secure Installation that comes with MariaDB. Running this tool starts a wizard that walks us through the process of making sure everything is secure. First, we are prompted to enter our current password for root or enter for none. We did not set one during installation, so we can just press enter here. As you can see on the screen, step by step. The next question asks if we want to set a root password, and of course we do, so press enter again to select the default value of yes. Choose a password that's easy to remember but difficult for others to guess. Next step, we need to remove anonymous users. This forces all users to have an account set up before they can connect. We will just hit enter to apply that. Now we remove remote access for the root account. This means no one can connect to our server as a root. They will have to be logged onto the server and then they can connect the root account and password. Next, we will remove the test database and apply the changes we have made so far. See how easy it was. to make our MariaDB installation secure, now we can get to the fun part of setting up the database that we will use for our LEMP demonstration. First, we will connect to the database as a root user with the MySQL client. We will enter MySQL space dash u space root space dash p. The dash u passes the user we want to connect as and dash p tells the MySQL client to prompt us for the password. Once we logged in, we can start creating our demo database with a few SQL commands. First, we will create the database, but only if it does not exist, which we know it does not, then we will create a user called admin. As you are seeing the step-by-step instruction, and then we will give the admin user all privileges on the appointment database using the password admin. And it looks like I have type. So I am just going to correct that real quick. Now let's disconnect from the root user and log in with the admin user. To log out, you can just type exit or press Ctrl D. And you see that MariaDB is so nice, it even says bye when we logged out. Now that we have account set up, we can use the MySQL command again. This time with admin as the user, and then we will use the password admin to log in. Once we logged in, we can check on the database we created with a few SQL commands. First, we just list the databases with the show databases command, and then we select the appointment databases with the use command. And finally, we take a look inside the appointments database with the show table command. We just created this database and haven't entered any data. So of course the database should be empty. Now that we have our MariaDB installed and our databases set up, we have all the component of our LEMP stack. So in next chapter we will go with the demonstration of LEMP stack. So be with me. See you in next lecture. At this point we are ready to add some dynamic content to our static site. We'll be setting up a PHP application that lists the appointment for the patient of Wisdom Pet Medicine. Application is the PHP script that connects to the appointment database. It reads the appointment and lists them in a table. It's a simple application, but it's perfect for demonstration how the components of LEMP stack work together. As I am connected to our development server where Nginx, MariaDB and PHP are installed and configured, let's change to the root user and do a quick check to make sure all of the systems are running as expected. We will use systemctl to check the status of each service. Nginx, MySQL and PHP-FPM. We could check each one individually, but fortunately we can use one call the systemctl and check them all at the same time. To get the actual info, we need let's pipe the output to grep and look for loaded and active. This output shows us that each service is running and active. We are good to go. If you are following along and your output differ from this review, the installation for each service and make any correction. Now let's install the PHP script. I'm using the exercise file so I can find the script in the vagrant directory, which is synchronized with the directory where I started the VM with vagrant up. The script is in the file named index.php. We won't be going into much detail about the code, but let's take a quick look at a few lines inside the script, and I'm going to go line 97. I wanted to point out the lines where two components of the stack come together, the PHP and the MySQL database. On this line, we see where PHP is using the MySQL I underscore connect function to connect the database on localhost, the user and password are there along with the name of the database. A few lines down on line 102, we see where PHP uses the MySQL I underscore query function to get all the rows from the data table of the appointment database. And on line 110, PHP print the data as HTML. Of course, this is the content we will see when the page is served by Nginx and loaded into our browser. Now let's put the script where Nginx can access it. We will make a directory inside the root of the website and call it appointments. And we can copy the index.php file to this directory. We also need to set a permission on the file to make sure the Nginx process can read it. It seems everything looks good. Now, this is a good time to point out why the file for our application is named index.php. Let's take a look inside the configuration for our site. Nginx is configured to use index.php as one of the files that get loaded by default when Nginx serves a directory. By naming our script index.php and then placing it in a directory named appointments, anytime someone requests the page slash appointments, the app will get loaded automatically. We could have used another name for the script appointments.php, for example, but using index.php makes things easier to manage if the appointment location needs other directives applied to it. Now let's take a look at our web app, and in browser I will go IP address for our development server, which is 192.168.0.3, and go to the appointments. We can see our application, but there is something missing, and this error tells us right away there's no data in our database. Let's fix that. In the vagrant directory, there are file named appointment underscore database.sql. This contains the data we need and the commands to insert them into the database. Before we do that, let's take a quick look inside the file. In the SQL file, we can see on this line, the very first line, where the table gets created along with the names of each column, and on line 13 is where the data insertion begins. The rest of the lines in the file are the rows of the data that make up the database. Now let's insert the data. We will use a standard in redirect to send the content of the SQL file into MySQL command, and we will use MySQL space dash u and then the admin user dash p, and then we specify the admin user password on the command line so that we are not prompted for it, and then we have specified the name of database that we want to inject this data into it, which is appointments. And now we can redirect our SQL file into this command. Now let's go back and refresh the appointment page. There's our data, as you can see on the screen. Now that database has some content. The page loads without an error. Now we can say we have successfully applied each component of the LEMP stack, and we added some dynamic content to our static site by applying some PHP code and some database content. But we are still not done. There are other things we can consider for our site, with security being the top priority. So let be with me and see you in next lecture. We will discuss about Nginx security. In this lecture, we will learn how to secure sites with Nginx. As we always hear news, website getting hacked or otherwise compromised, and the resulting damage that these intrusion can cause. So as you are learning about Nginx, you might be wondering, what can I do with Nginx to help keep my site secure? Here are a few things you should consider when it comes to Nginx and security. The first thing you can do is make sure your operating system and software are using the latest version possible and have all security updates applied. This will help make sure you are protected against known vulnerabilities. Next, you can restrict access to certain parts of your sites. We will take a look at how we can configure Nginx to allow access to certain pages based on IP address. You can also use passwords. This can help keep sensitive information protected and slow down intruders. And you can also apply SSL or secure socket layer. SSL actually is a protocol for establishing encrypted link between a web server and a browser. This helps keep communication private between the web server and the person requesting the content. Also, using SSL certificates that have been verified can help to identify sites as being who they say they are. Earlier in the course, we discussed installing the latest version of Ubuntu and Nginx. Now let's take a closer look at other ways we can keep things secure on the website. In this lecture, we're going to learn how to configure and allow or deny directives. Limiting access is one of the ways we can help secure the content of a site. Fortunately, Nginx provides the HTTP access module that includes allow and deny directives. These are used to limit who is allowed to see certain content and who gets denied. Let's take a look at how these directives are configured and how we can use them. If you are following along the exercise file, you can use the Vagrant file in the folder for this lesson. It will boot the VM and install Nginx and all supporting software and data for our demo site. If you are not using exercise file, you can follow along with VM running Ubuntu 18.04 LTS. You will need root access and you will need to install Nginx. Let's start by considering a page in our demo site that we want to protect. One of the most sensitive pages on our website is the appointment page. This page contains or personally identifiable information, but the clinic patient and their owners, this information that we don't want to general public to have access to. So let's configure Nginx to first deny everyone from seeing this page. The server is already up and running, so I just need to connect to it with Vagrant SSH, and I will elevate to the root user. As the root user, let's edit the vhost for the site and create location for the appointment directory. I will use via editor to edit the vhost for our demo site, and now I will add a location for appointments. Now we can add the deny directive and use the keyword all to tell Nginx not to serve this page to anyone. As you can see on the screen, as always, let's test the configuration and then reload it. I will save the file and use nginx -t and then system reload Nginx to reload it. Got those in the wrong order. Now I will save the file. As always, let's test the configuration and the reload it. I will test with nginx-t, then clear the screen, and then I will use the system reload nginx to reload the configuration again. Now let's see what happened when we try to access the appointment location in our browser. With our deny all directive applied, Nginx is refusing to serve the page and instead shows a ugly page with 403 forbidden. This works, but we don't want to have a web server that just forbids everyone from seeing the file it serves. Let's configure the location so that only requests coming from our internal network can see the appointment page, and I will scroll up to use the same VR editor. Edit the vhost file again. Back in the vhost file, I will use allow directive along with IP range to let Nginx knows what network can access this site. For the addresses, the notation we are using here is called SID or notation, or classes inter-domain routing notation. It's a shorthand way to represent a range of IP addresses. In this case, we are seeing all IP addresses that start with 192.168.0 and any address that start with 10 are allowed to access this location. These are the network that our server uses, so allow request from those network and deny request from any other networks. Let's test this configuration and we will save the vhost, and again do nginx space dash small t and system reload and system ctl space reload nginx, and now let's refresh the appointment location. Now you can see our page is now only served to any requests that come from our internal network. For more information on configuring allow and deny, take a look at the documentation on nginx.org. One more thing we can also address is that default nginx 403 page, which does not look very good. So in next lecture, we're going to create a 403 page. So be with me. See you in next lecture. In this lecture, we're going to learn how to create a 403 page. Along with using the allow and deny directive, we can add a custom 403 page. So even though we might be denying somebody from viewing a page, we can still give them something pretty to look at. First, let's create a location that always denied. So we can see the default page generated by nginx. So let's edit our vhost configuration file. I will add a location called slash deny and use the deny all directive. Now let's save this and test it out, and I will use nginx space dash t small to test the configuration and reload it with systemctl space reload space nginx. Now let's open the browser and try out deny location. So we see the 403 forbidden page generated by nginx. Let's create a custom 403 page so we don't see this default page and create something that's little bit more in line with our website. Let's edit our vhost configuration file. You might recall that we already have a configuration for handling 404 errors. Let's use that code over again for our 403 error, and what I will do is just replace the 404 in this section with 403. Previously, we used one custom page for all of our 500 errors. In this case, though, we won't use one section for all the 400 errors, since file not found and you are forbidden are two different errors. So now let's save the file and test our configuration again and then reload it with systemctl, and now let's make and customize our 403 page. I will start by copying the 404 page and then modifying it for our 403 page. In our custom 403 file, I will just make changes to the 404 error so they apply to the 403 forbidden error a little bit more appropriately. And now I will save the file and open the browser, and we can test out our custom 403 page. And there's our custom 403 page. This definitely looks better than nginx default 403 page. So in next lecture, we're going to learn how to configure password authentication. So be with me. See you in next lecture. Username and password are an important part of limiting access and keeping things secure online. Let's use Nginx, HTTP, auth basic module to configure a simple username and password prompt to protect parts of our website. We have already configured our Nginx server to only allow access to appointment pages from our network. But even if the page is being accessed from someone on our network, we still might want to limit who can see this information. This is good cause for using basic authentication, which will require anyone who is accessing the page to enter a username and password. Let's go back to terminal and connect to our development environment. Our server is already up, so I am going to connect to it with the vagrant SSH, and then I will elevate this session to use the root user. Now we can install AT password, a utility that lets us easily create a password file. Nginx does not ship with the utility to create a password files, so we need to use the one that comes with Apache. We can get it without having to completely install Apache by just installing the Apache 2- utility package, and I will do that with apt space install space apache 2- utils. Now we can create a password file. It's important to not store the password file in a location that can be accessed by anyone browsing the website. In some cases, developers include the password file in the root directory and then configure the web server to not serve anything that starts with the password file name. But we can avoid that altogether by keeping the password file outside of the root directory. Let's create it in the etc nginx directory. We will do this by running et password-c, the path to the file, and then a username you want to create a password for. I will use admin. The -c is needed to create the file, as you can see on the screen. Running this command prompt us to enter a new password, and I will use admin, and then it prompt up to confirm the password by retyping it. If we want to add new user to the file, we can rerun the command without the -c. Note that if you use the -c option and the file exists, it will be overwritten. So be careful when you are adding new users. Let's add two more user and their password, and I will add user 1 and just add password for this user, and then I will add user 2. We can also change a user password by running the command again with the username. We will prompt it to enter a new password and then of course to confirm it by retyping it. If we need to remove a user, we can use the dash capital D switch with the file and the name of the user to delete. After that, user and his password will be deleted from the file. Also, the password file is just a plain text file that can be viewed like any other file. So if I cat this file, we can see the content of it on the screen. Let's change the permission for this file so that it can only be read by the user account that nginx uses, like www-data and of course the root user. And we will do that with chown change ownership www-data, as you can see on the screen, and then the path to the file. This will change the owner of the file to the www-data user, and now let's change the permission on it with the chmod space 600 and then the path to the file. Now if we look at the permission for the file, we can make sure our changes have been applied. Now let's configure nginx to use this password file in our demo site. We will do that by editing the vhost file for our demo site. In the appointment location, we will add the auth basic directive and a message. Some browser will display this message along with a password prompt. We will also add the auth basic user file directive and the path to our password file, and the path to our file is etc/nginx/passwords. Because the appointment location also serves PHP, we need to copy the PHP configuration into the code block. So if we scroll down the file, we can find this location here where nginx is configured to process our PHP files. And I will just go through these lines so that I can paste them back into appointment location, and I will just clean things up a bit. This is not required, but I like to keep my configuration file a little bit neat. Copying the PHP location into the appointment location is important because once nginx processes the appointment location, it won't process the top level PHP location as well. So we need to add it here as well. So nginx knows how to handle any PHP file it encounters in the appointment location. Now let's save the file, test it, and apply the new configuration. If we go back to the appointment page and reload, we should be prompted now for a username and password. And I will enter the username password we set up with the admin and admin. Now we just confirm that our appointment page is protected. That should keep things just a little bit more secure. For more information on configuring password authentication, you can refer to documentation for the auth basic module on nginx.org. In this lecture, we are going to configuring HTTPS. HTTPS, Hypertext Transport Protocol, or HTTP, is the basic protocol that web server use to fulfill request. HTTPS is secure version of that protocol. HTTPS protect the information being sent between the server and the client by encrypting it. This is important for protecting sites that use sensitive information like credit card or social security number. SSL or secure socket layer is the name of the first method developed to encrypt web traffic. Since SSL can be reversed, using SSL has been deprecated and has fallen out of use. Instead, HTTPS now uses TLS or transport layer security as the method for encrypting traffic. So even though TLS is used in favorite over SSL, you will still hear people referring to SSL when they refer to certificate, keys, and so on. In fact, nginx provides the HTTP SSL module for configuring site for HTTPS. So let's configure a self-signed SSL certificate and then use the directive from the HTTP SSL module to serve our site over HTTPS. I already have our development VM booted up, but before we go to the terminal, let's take a look at the site in the Chrome browser. And if I click on this little I write next to our IP address in the browser, I get a message, a little pop-up from the Chrome. Since we are not serving over HTTPS yet, most browser will let us know that by seeing something like this site is not secure. Now we will take the step to fix that error. In next chapter, we are going to create SSL certificate. So be with me. See you in next lecture. In this lecture, we are going to learn how to create an SSL certificate. If your site will be accessible to the general public on the internet, you will want to get an SSL certificate from a known certificate authority like Encrypt, Symantec, that will allow your site to be identified and trusted. For development and testing through, we can generate our own SSL certificate. It won't be trusted, but it will allow us to configure nginx with SSL. So let's connect to our development environment and become the root user. This first thing we need to do is create an SSL certificate and key. We'll be using the OpenSSL command line tool to do that. You can check for it by typing which open SSL, if it is missing, you can install it with apt space install space openssl. There are several methods for creating SSL certificate. We are going to use the simplest one, which creates a key and a certificate in one command. We will start by typing openssl and then req, which is a short of request, and then -x509 to indicate that we want to generate an x509 certificate. Then we will type -nodes to instruct OpenSSL to not use the DES encryption method. Then we will use -days and type 365. This is the length of time that our certificate will be valid. Then we'll type -newkey instructing OpenSSL to generate a new key. Then we will add RSA :2048. This will tell OpenSSL to use RSA encryption method and use 2048 bit key. Then we'll type -keyout and the path to where we want to OpenSSL to store the key that it generates. And we will type /etc/ssl/private/nginx.key. Now we all type -out and then path to certificate that OpenSSL will generate, and we will use /etc/ssl/certs/nginx.cert, and now we will press enter. This command creates a key and then immediately uses that key to sign the certificate. We are prompted for the specifics of the certificate, like our physical address, email address and name of the site. Since we are just working with self-signed certificate on a development site, using the defaults is a fine, so you can just press enter for each of these questions. If you are generating a certificate for a public site, you would want to enter the specific detail for your site through. Also, if you want to remove the prompt altogether, you can use the -batch switch. So let me just demonstrate that by going back to our previous command and adding -batch on the end. As you can see, the key was generated and we were not prompted to enter any of that information that we were in the last time. In any case, the command places the new certificate in the etc SSL cert and the key in etc SSL private. The certificate can be public. Since our server will use identify itself over HTTPS, the key need to stay private, since that the file that will be used to encrypt the traffic, if the key is exposed, then someone could potentially traffic sent to your server. In this lecture, we are going to install an SSL certificate on Nginx. Now that we have our certificate and key, we need to configure Nginx to use them. Let's edit the site configuration file. The first thing we will do, force all traffic to served using HTTPS. We will do this by creating a new default server that listen on port 80. We don't need a root location for the server, because what we will do instead is redirect all traffic to HTTPS with the return directive. So if any requests come to port 80, they will get a 301 code which will permanently redirect to the browser to different address. So I will also need to provide the address, and for that we will use HTTPS and variable, and the variables that hold the server address and the request URI. This will effectively redirect any traffic that hits the site from 80 to port 443, which is the port that HTTPS traffic is served over. Now we can save the file and test the configuration before loading it. Now let's reload the page, the browser. We are seeing your connection is not a private message from Chrome browser now. This is a good thing. It means our SSL certificate is in place and our site is serving HTTPS properly. Chrome uses this page to tell us that it cannot identify the site is actually who it says it is. Since we signed the certificate ourselves, we could be anyone, so Chrome and other browser will give the nice warning to let us know to keep an eye out for anything that might be suspicious. Other browser like Firefox, for example, even give you an option for storing exception to sites that we know. In this case, we know it's our own site, so we can proceed, and I will click advanced and then click proceed to our site. And now we see our site and we can check the address bar to see that our site is serving HTTPS. Chrome still says our connection is not secure, but the difference here is that we have a certificate in place. Now, if we click where it says certificate, we can see the certificate that Chrome has processed for our website. We did not enter any specific for this key, so these values are just defaults from our OpenSSL configuration. If the certificate was actually issued by a certificate authority like Let's Encrypt, Semantic, or other, we would see their information here instead, and if that was the case, our site would be trusted by the browser and we could see a green lock icon in the address bar instead of this red triangle. The good thing about our configuration now is that all content, even the images, are being sent over HTTPS. So I close this and go to the appointment page. We get prompted for a password, and the password is sent from our browser to the server over HTTPS. We know that Nginx can be used as a web server for static files and as a platform for dynamic sites when paired with PHP and MySQL. Now let's take a look of two other ways of Nginx can be used: as a reverse proxy and a load balancer. I may refer to reverse proxy as a just proxy, but now that I am referring to the same thing, proxies and load balancer provide very similar functions. In both cases, a server running as a proxy or load balancer site between a client and some resources that can be fulfilled request from the client. The client connect to the proxy or load balancer on the front end, and the proxy connect to the server or resource on the back end and return the response to the client. With proxies and load balancer providing what looks like a very similar function, you might be wondering what's the difference between them. Let's take a closer look. A reverse proxy applies to the case where there are only one server on the backend. This could be web application implemented in Python or Node.js. For example, it could even be another web server running Apache, Tomcat, or even Nginx. In these cases, Nginx is great at simplifying things that might be harder to implement in other technologies, like SSL termination and logging. Nginx proxies are also good for accelerating the response of the backend server by caching content. By storing frequently requested content, Nginx can reduce the load on backend servers and respond to the client request more quickly. Nginx also has capability to compress data, which can reduce the amount of network bandwidth needed to fulfill a request. Acting as a load balancer, Nginx offers the same capability as a reverse proxy. But instead of only connecting to one server on the backend, a load balancer connects to multiple servers. This configuration is useful for applications that require more than one backend server to handle a larger number of clients or a high volume of traffic, for example, with more than one server, a site or application can be more reliable by continuing to respond to requests even if one server goes down. This also gives site administrators some flexibility for maintenance, since they can take one server offline to update software, for example, without taking the entire site offline. So there is a high availability between the application tier. Depending on the needs of application, as long as one server is online, the site will still up. Another feature of load balancer is enabling session persistence. This is useful when clients need the same server to accept and respond to all of their requests. Let's consider an example application that requires a client to log in and the user account information, which is stored locally on the server. If the client's requests were routed to a different server each time, the client might have to log in over and over again. Instead, session persistence routes all connection to the same server they started on until they log out. Now that we have an understanding of proxies and load balancing, let's discuss the upstream directive and how to define the server that Nginx connect to when acting as a reverse proxy or load balancer. So be with me in next lecture. We are going to configure a reverse proxy. So see you in next lecture. Now that we have discussed reverse proxies and load balancer, let's take a look at how they implemented. The upstream module is one of the key components used to configure Nginx for proxying and load balancing. You can find more information on the upstream directive in the documentation of nginx.org. Before we can set up a proxy or a load balancer in Nginx, we need to define the backend servers that Nginx will be connecting. This is where the upstream directive comes into play. If we consider Nginx configuration, there are certain contexts where we can apply directives. We can apply them at the global context that affects all of Nginx. The HTTP context for items that work with the HTTP protocol, and inside the HTTP context, servers and location context, for example, that specifically configure virtual host and the URI used to access them, upstreams or defined in the HTTP context. This is useful so that one upstream can be defined and then reused by multiple servers also defined in the HTTP context. As a side note, we refer to these resources as an upstream because in the flow of the web request, the resources would be upstream from an Nginx server and the client. Let's go to our development server and configure our first upstream resource. As the root user, let's create a configuration file called upstream.conf under /etc/nginx/config.d. As you can see on the screen, since Nginx is configured to read all the file in the config.d directory that end in .conf, this is a good location to store our upstream configuration files. First, we need to add our upstream block along with a name for it. We will call this upstream block app_server_7001. I am including the 7001 just to note the port that the app server is listening on. This is not a requirement but just a naming convention. You can use any name you like for an upstream block. Now inside this block, we can define the server that are part of the upstream. In this case, let's set up the one server listening on port 7001. The server statement on an upstream log is different from a server statement you use to define a virtual host. In this case of an upstream server, we have to include the name or IP address of the server that this block connects. We could also use a unit socket if the backend server is listening on socket. But in this case, the server is another HTTP process running on the same VM as our Nginx process. So we'll use the localhost IP address 127.0.0.1 and also indicate the port 7001. Now that we have our upstream defined, we need to connect to it. To connect to an upstream, we need to have a server block. In this case, we will use the same file that our upstream is defined. It's not a requirement to have these in the same file, but we will do like that now for simplicity, and we will have it listen on port 80 and add a location and name is /proxy. Now I can add the proxy with the proxy pass directive. This comes from the Nginx HTTP proxy module. For more information on the proxy module, you can refer to the documentation on nginx.org. Let's discuss this for a moment. The server we just defined will listen on port 80. If a request comes in on /proxy, the server will use the location that match, so it will send their traffic into the /proxy location for processing. With the proxy post directive, the request will be sent to the HTTP resource defined in the upstream named app server 7001, which in this case our process listening on 7001. In the response generated by the upstream is then returned to Nginx to be sent back to the client. I'm also going to add a comment here, just a reminder that the trailing slash on a proxy pass statement is a key. Without the trailing slash, Nginx would try to connect to a location named /proxy on the backend server. In most cases, you will want to proxy to the root of the backend server and let the application route the request as needed. So enough talking about this configuration, let's see how it works. First, we will save the file, test the configuration and reload it. The app server we will be connecting to just return the port that it's listening on and the time the page was served. So we should see 7001 when we load /proxy on an VM IP address. So it works by hitting /proxy on our demo VM. We are successfully proxying through Nginx to the app server on port 7001. If we refresh the page a few times, we can see the time changes as well, indicating we are getting new content from the application server, app server. So be with me in next lecture. We are going to configure Nginx as a load balancer. So see you in next lecture. Proxying and load balancing are similar function for Nginx. But you have no idea how similar they are. In fact, they are pretty much the same. The only difference is the number of servers in the upstream and the method used to connect to each of the servers in turn. The documentation at nginx.org gives more detail on using Nginx as a load balancer. Let's take a look at the different load balancing method Nginx uses. Nginx uses three methods to connect to upstream servers: round robin, least connections, and IP hashing. These methods are indicated with with directives apply within an upstream block. The default method is round robin and there is no directive to use this method. Requests are sent to each upstream server one at a time with no preference given to the server. This is an easy, reasonable method for evenly distributing a load over several servers. With the least connection method, Nginx considers the number of connections an upstream server is already processing. The server with the fewest connection will be preferred for every new request that come in. Third one is the IP hash method is used for session persistence. This method considers the IP address of the client making the request and then choose an upstream server to handle the request. If the client IP address stays the same upstream server will handle any future request made by the client. The wait directive is used to influence the other load balancing methods. Since each server is considered evenly in the round robin method and by connections in the least connection method, a wait can be applied to a server to give it a higher preferences. Take for example a group of upstream servers where one server has twice the CPU or more memory compared to other servers. We give that server a higher weight so Nginx can route more traffic to it. Now let's take a look at how we implement each of these load balancing methods. I am connected to our development VM as a root user and I will edit the file /etc/nginx/config.d/upstream.conf. We already have one upstream defined and it includes just one server. Please note that I put all commands in text file. You can just copy and paste to this configuration file. As you can see on the screen, if we make an upstream with more than one server, Nginx will treat an proxy underscore pass connection to it as a load balancer. So let's make another upstream block and call it round robin. I am calling this block round robin to describe the way we will configure Nginx to connect to the servers in this block. Calling this block round robin is not a requirement. It's just a naming convention I am using for demonstration purpose. Now let's add our server. I will add three servers and you will recognize one of them from the other upstream block in the configuration. So I have added three servers, all running on the local host and all listening on the different ports. One of these servers, the one listening on 7001 is also in the app underscore server underscore 7001 upstream block. Nginx allows servers to be used in multiple upstreams. This is useful in cases where we have upstream servers that provide different functionality that we might want to use in different ways. Now let's add the location that connect to the upstream. This is almost exactly the same as our proxy location. The only difference is the upstream we are connecting to, and again I have called this location round robin just for demonstration purpose. Now let's save the file and test this configuration typing nginx space dash small t. In the browser, we will connect to the slash round robin location on our development VM IP. Each server in our load balancer should respond with the port it's listening to one after the other. Let's give it a shot. The first response we get in 7001, which is good. Now if we refresh the page a few times, we should see the port for each of three app underscore servers. And indeed, each app underscore server is responding in turn. Now let's configure example for the other load balancing method. I will go back into our configuration file and add a few more new upstreams. To start, I will just copy the round robin upstream block and paste it three times. and then I will rename these new upstreams that I copied as the least connections or least cone, in short, then IP hash and weighted. As you can see on the screen, again, these are not requirement for each of these load balancing method to work. I'm just naming these upstream blocks this way for discussion purpose for each of the ways that we can configure load balancing in Nginx. So now we need to indicate the method we want to use in each upstream block. I will add least underscore con to the least connections upstream, IP underscore hash to the IP hash upstream, and I will put a weight of 2 on the first server in the weighted upstream. Now let's create a location for each of these new upstream, and again I will just copy the round robin location and change it for the new methods we are demonstrating, and I will rename these to match the location we want connect to, and then update the proxy underscore pass location. Now let's save the file and test this configuration before we reload it. Now let's go to the browser and test each of these load balancing methods. Let's try least connection first. The least connection method is kind of hard to test in our demo environment because we can't create enough connection to see which upstream server is getting the most connections. So if I refresh the page a few times, it looks more like a round robin method is being used. This is reasonable since the round robin methods is the default load balancing method. Let's try the IP hash method. Connected to the IP hash location, if I refresh the page a few times, we see the same port number displayed each time. This makes a little bit more sense. We are using the same IP address to connect to our demo server. So Nginx will keep routing us to the same server on the backend. Now let's look at weighted upstream. In this case, we have three servers in the upstream, with the 7001 server having a weight of 2. We are also using the default round robin method. So what we should see in Nginx connect to 7001 twice as much as 7002 and 7003 servers. Let's give it a shot. On our first load, we get 7001. If I load again, we still see 7001, but the time changed, as you can see on the screen. Now if I refresh again, we see 7002 and one more time, and now we see 7003 and again 7001, 7001, 7002 and 7003. Sure enough, Nginx is giving more requests to the 7001 server since it has the higher weight. Now we have seen a few different ways that Nginx can be configured for load balancing. I hope you understand all methods of load balancing step by step.